officiating. What are you going to be wearing?
Next question. I'm putting you on the hot seat today. You're not putting me on the hot seat. I know you can do that. I know you're good. You're good at that.
Stick with stalemate stuff, or I mean, I could tell you that we like each other, but we don't like each other, and we're incredibly competitive with one another, and we both want to whoop each other's ass. But at the end of the day, we have a healthy respect for one another, and we'll shake each other's hands. There won't be certain back and forth. And if we win, we'll take it like men, like we have the last 2 years, or we lose, we'll take it like men, like we have. Now, unfortunately, the last 2 years, you know, they've been tight duels that Iowa State's found a way to win, you know, so I give them credit and they're doing a good job, but we're certainly not going to back down from them any way, shape or form. But when it's done, it's done. And then we got to get back to work. And if we got to get better, we got to get better. That's on us. I'm not going to get into that stuff or play those games, but I will shake hands and I won't tell any of their guys certain things.
All right, what's up, Stalemates? We are back with another episode. One camera still. Looking for that second tripod, if you guys have seen it.
All around us. Somewhere. Might be in Iowa City.
Might be in Iowa City at the Vine still. It doesn't matter. Appreciate everybody for watching. A lot of new people on the show lately. And if you don't know, we're presented by Barbarian Apparel, the number one apparel business in the wrestling game. If you guys need custom team apparel, I can't stress this enough. Use Josh at Barbarian Apparel. They're awesome. That's all I got to say. Above and beyond Wash and Seal as well. If you're in central Iowa and you need a new floor for your gym, garage, house, basement, shop, barbershop, podcast studio, hit up Trent at Above and Beyond Wash and Seal. We have 5 new topics this week. Awesome topics. Tyler and I were out in Illinois at a wedding over the weekend. We had a good time. Didn't get too much sleep. Downed some adult beverages. Had some good food. I kind of missed out on a lot of dual meets, but I've been getting caught up. A lot of drama going on. A lot of tea. We're going to get to it. Roll the intro. All right, what's up, everybody? We have an awesome show for you guys. Okay, we're gonna talk about Little Rock. Tristan Wills getting tapped out, knocked out, not knocked out,
choked out.
Austin Gomez, a little bit of heel action going on in Carver Hawkeye Arena. Respect. AJ Ferrari update. Justin Gaethje and Mikey England. All right, let's get into it. The Little Rock saga that went on, the saga that happened here. What do you know about this, Tyler?
I'd seen over the weekend that people were really upset about someone getting choked out, and I was wanting to find the clip really bad. I feel like it took a little while to surface, and then saw this clip. It is pretty, I don't know if terrifying is the right word, but it's scary to see it happen to Little Rock. Here. Oh, no, this is in Oklahoma.
Yeah, so Anthony Mantanona and Tristan Wills. We got to meet Tristan at when we went down to Little Rock. Really nice guy. Transfer in from Oklahoma State. But you see he's on top here. Mantanona's on the bottom. And look, he's out.
Right there.
Look, and watch Erisman's reaction here. Just pissed, as he should be.
Heated.
You know, and I don't think... I don't think that he's mad at the ref by any means. I don't think that he's mad at the wrestler by any means, but he's clearly mad at the ref, as he should be. There's two refs there, right? That's why we have two refs, so we can, you know...
Prevent that.
Yeah, prevent anything like that from happening. Someone's kind of paying attention to the actual match and the score and everything, and then the other ref's kind of there to kind of oversee everything just in case the head official misses anything. Mm. Clearly, they missed what was going on, and this was... You know, at the expense of this wrestler here. But it seems like this Mantanona guy has had problems before. People are saying that he did something similar in the you and I dual meet. And this is something where I don't know if it's intentional by any means or if he just kind of likes this move and maybe he does it the wrong way. And essentially, they call it the snake or whatever. They think that... I don't know if he does it intentionally or not. But here's something that I don't think a lot of people are realizing, right? Seth Duckworth put up this clip of Mantanona wrestling 2 days later. I don't know who exactly who they're wrestling against.
But it was 2 days after this Little Rock incident.
He's in the same position as he was, or a similar position as, you know, the Wills match. And he looks to the ref and kind of shows the ref what he's doing. So
here we go.
This is 2 days after he chokes out Tristan Wills. So he's in this kind of front headlock position. And look, like look at him show the ref. He's waving his hand like, hey, look, I'm good, right? And the ref's clearly looking.
Don't be afraid to hit that, Eric.
Don't be afraid, hit it.
Yeah, let's go, Eric. Okay. And, you know, probably could have did without the Sooners, you know, kind of mocking
it
a little bit.
That's why Seth posted it.
Right.
And he had replies to it as well.
Yeah, Gaga.
The wrestler himself.
Yeah, so go ahead and show what Anthony actually put up.
Showed Anthony. The ref my hand to make sure we were good. Don't want anyone getting hurt by me in a match again. Seth said he's not talking about him. He's talking about the fans who were talking in the background. And then he said, I know I haven't posted on Twitter about this, but I wanted this video to come out. I consciously showed the ref my position to make sure no future injuries were possible. Wanted to be on the same page as the official. So he was trying to do a little bit of cleanup control a little bit just to make sure that wasn't happening again.
Yeah, and I don't want to like... I don't really want to crap on this kid. Who knows if he's – who knows if he's – I know people have said he's done it in the past, but if you've never choked anybody out before, maybe if no one's ever really called you on it, you might not know that you're doing it wrong, right?
Right. Most of the outrage was with the officials. It wasn't for the wrestler.
Yeah, and we actually got a couple other instances where this has happened before. Tyler found this old clip that he remembers from –
2012. I was in high school whenever I first watched this, but this was at a last chance qualifier for the Olympics that year. This is Hathaway and Troy Nickerson.
Yeah, if you're from Iowa, you definitely know who Jack Hathaway is. It's kind of a different position there.
Yeah, I couldn't quite make out what exactly was going on. He definitely had an arm caught in there too, but Hathaway was out.
You know, the thing is, like, even though it's illegal to have just the neck or just the head like that, you got to have an arm in there.
Mm-hmm.
There's still chokes out there where you have the arm, right? So
100%.
I'm not a big jiu-jitsu guy. I'm not going to claim to act like I know about jiu-jitsu or anything like that. I've never taken a jiu-jitsu class in my life. Obviously, I watch a lot of UFC. I'm just a UFC fan. Never done any sort of combat sport outside of wrestling. But I believe it's the, now they call it the OSP choke. And you basically have the arm with it, and you basically shut off whatever, what artery is that right there? You guys don't, first of all, you guys don't come to stalemates for any sort of like
technical
breakdowns or anything like that. But this is obviously has a lot to do with technique. And I don't want people to think that it's only, you can only choke people out by just having your arms around the neck, which... This is why the officials are so important, and this is why this whole situation, I think people should be more mad at the officials than they should be mad at Mantanona, whether he has a history about it or not, I don't know. It's freaking hard to go back and find matches of his because Oklahoma is stupid, and they have that stupid, they have some stupid streaming service that you only get their matches, and you it's not an ESPN Plus, it's not anything else, so it's kind of hard to go back and find matches of this kid and see if he's looking for this or not. But here's Cassiope doing it to this Purdue guy that I think a lot of people didn't know that this happened.
And yeah, this is beginning of January. I had not caught this happening.
And me showing you guys this, this isn't me saying like trying to dunk on Iowa by any means. I don't think Cassiope even knew. This is a position that we see quite a bit. He has a leg turked and it looks like he's going to do a cross face or something, and he goes kind of more on the neck region.
There's some pretty funny reactions in this, so if you pay attention closely.
Obviously probably forgot that, and it's not about him, it's about how great Gable is.
Look, he's out right he's out. He's out there.
Yep.
Look, he's already out. He's out.
I like the look him and I think Telford give each other though.
I don't even know.
Wait. Okay, he looks back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
he had a little smile when he walked off once he finally regained.
That was actually a good catch. I missed that the first time. That point being, you know, if this kid is you know, maliciously doing it, and he does it again. I don't think he's going to do it again. If he was doing this stuff maliciously beforehand, he's not going to probably do it again, because now the eyes are definitely on him.
Spot's hot now.
Right. Yeah. So it sucks. I think this is a huge tip of the cap to the Little Rock guys, because they had, if that was any other, you know, a lot of other coaches, they would have definitely got team points taken away. They would have probably got themselves ejected.
Which they challenged it, and they lost the challenge, so they did get a team point deducted.
I think the biggest thing is how that's not a disqualification instead of a pin, but I'm not going to sit here and try to break the rule down for you guys.
Right.
But, you know, Neil Arisman's, we got to meet him when we went down to Arkansas, and they're just top tier, you know, all of them. And you see, like, his rage kind of set in at the very beginning, and then whenever he kind of his brain immediately clicks to, like, no, we got to make sure that our guy gets back on his feet. And, you know, it sucks that you lose a match that way. Was Wills up at that time?
Wills?
You know? Was he winning at that time and then lost? I mean, he's a good wrestler.
I think this caption here was saying that he was. They say that Mantanana was getting manhandled.
He was getting manhandled by Tristan Wills before. Does it say the score? Can you see it real quick?
So he choked. What does that say?
4-1.
4-1, if that's the individual score.
And what period was that, do you know?
It looks like it's saying the first.
Yeah, that's tough. You're up 4-1 on a guy like Mantanona, who's ranked. That would have been a good win for him, and then you get choked out. So that's the unfortunate thing there. I think it should have been a disqualification rather than getting, you know, a six the other way.
Yeah, that's tough to see.
All right, let's move on. Let's move on to Scared Money Don't Make Money himself. So this kind of came on my radar pretty quickly, right? Because anything to do with Iowa, people, it's polarizing, right? You have, I don't know if you guys know this, but if you ever go to an NCAA wrestling tournament and there's an Iowa guy on the mat, the entire arena is going to either cheer or boo depending on what happens. Mm-hmm. Iowa guy wins, a large portion of the audience goes crazy because it's a lot of Hawkeye fans. I mean, this fan base, they're selling out arenas. They probably have the highest average dual attendance. Mm-hmm. The season tickets were sold out for the entire year, right? They have the number one, number two ranked team, number two right now. Anyways, they have a crazy passionate fan base. And anytime you have this many people in an arena, it's going to be wild. It's going to be hectic. It's going to be crazy.
Yeah.
Do lines get crossed from time and time again? Does it happen frequently? Yes, it does. Just on the Penn State duel, they chucked the beer, right?
Right.
Austin Gomez, you know, he goes into Carver Hawkeye Arena undefeated. He has a win over DeSanto. Anytime you're a wrestler who doesn't get beat by Hawkeyes, they don't like you even more.
Right.
And that's just part of like a super passionate fan base, you know? And so anytime something like this happens, you have the other half of the arena, right, that goes nuts and they boo and they hate you. And then if you do any sort of celebrating or showboating or anything like that, you are now enemy number one. And that's kind of what happens here. Austin Gomez is wrestling Vince Turk on senior night. Obviously, Turk is a crowd favorite. Let me say something about Turk real quick. Turk is one of those guys who goes to Iowa because he wants to be a Hawkeye. I don't know if it was a lifelong dream of his, but this kid qualified for an NCAA wrestling tournament, what, 2 or 3 years ago?
Yeah.
Nobody really picked him to be an All-American. He ended up not being an All-American, but he wrestled well above his seed or what I think most people would have predicted him. I think he made it all the way to the blood round, maybe. I think he lost in the first round. I think it was one of those deals, and he wrestled all the way back. So he is a crowd favorite for the Iowa Hawkeyes. We haven't seen him in a while because Max Buren's been in the spot. Pat Lugo's been in the spot. There's been other guys. Seabrick has been in the spot. So the crowd loves Turk. So he finally gets to go out there. He gets a ranked opponent. The kid is good.
Senior night.
Even though it's a backup, I know people are like, oh, you can't, you know, Gomez is going to showboat here, and you'll see. Even though it's a backup or whatever, and you're not supposed to showboat if you beat the backup, that's what people say. That's not me saying that. Other people say that. This kid's good. This kid could go wrestle on a lot of other Division I teams, and you know, he probably could have been an All-American if he had four solid shots at it. But anyways, here's the clip. So some unnecessary shoving at the end, a little bit. Whatever, close match, one takedown match. Some more John.
Yep.
Look at this. Look at this. Makes you want to run through a wall. Look at that. Bono's loving it. Oh, little point back. All right, here's where it gets ugly, right?
Yeah. You can tell too by his reaction. Someone said something that stood out.
Somebody said something, turned around. Hit the heavyweight there, John Adam. All right, so here's the reality of it, right? The Gomez family put out some statements saying that their son was called a word that I will not say.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can put two and two together. He's got a Mexican heritage, Mexican background. Shout out to my Mexican brother. And somebody said something to him. And you can see at the end here, if you want to fast forward to the end and we'll show it, right? I don't know exactly what was said, but they're saying that they said a racial slur at him.
Right here. Someone definitely said something.
Somebody definitely, look, can you go back a little bit more where he's just kind of walking normal? All right, let's just see. I'll watch this. All right, there you go. Watch, he's kind of minding his own business doing that. He turns around. Listen, I don't care who you are. If you're an Iowa Hawkeye fan, if you're an Iowa State fan, if you're a Wisconsin fan, if you're a freaking Little Rock Trojan fan, right? You do not want these kind of people in your fan base.
Mm-hmm.
And this isn't me like going after Iowa. I think Iowa kind of gets they get the raw end of the deal because they have this moniker of them being who they are and who they are, or whatever. It doesn't matter who you are. Whether or not something was said here or not, right? Because do I believe it happened? It's not beyond the most. It's not like super outrageous to think that this would happen at Iowa, right? Mm-hmm. I think if people voted where it most likely happened, a lot of people would probably say it probably happened at Carver Hawkeye. When you have that many people there, there's a chance. There's a higher percent of a chance that there's going to be a real jerk there, right? A lot of the Iowa people have been great to us, and we love going to Carver Hawkeye Arena. But when this stuff happens, you got to be the ones to weed this stuff out, right? If you see somebody sitting next to you and they say something like that, call them out.
Mm-hmm.
Do something about it, you know? And who knows if something was said or not. We have Gomez family saying it does happen. It's not an impossible situation to occur. Let's take this whole situation out of it anyways. If you've been to any sort of sporting events, we hear this kind of stuff happen.
Yeah.
The Red Sox went through it a few years ago when, you know, there were certain players saying that the Boston fan base says stuff like this. You can't let these people sit around you. I don't care who you are. If you hear something like that, call them out. It's a sore eye to everybody. It's a sore eye. And I'm not going to pin like people saying this is bad for the sporting thing. This has nothing to do with wrestling. This just has to do with shitty people. Mm. There's shitty people everywhere. A kid like Austin Gomez, you guys should be thanking him, right? You guys should be thanking, like Iowa fans, you should be thanking a guy like Austin Gomez for bringing that energy. You know, we want to complain when people duck and the wrestling's not as good and we want the best matchups. He went in there and entertained you guys. Just like Starachi, after the Iowa-Penn State duel, he was thanking all those fans that booed him and said things to him. I don't know what, you know, all these things, right? They said these nasty things about Starachi. You know, nothing. People said there was no race involved or anything like that. Yeah. But people were, you know, booing him and this and that. And Starachi went online. He's like, hey, thank you. Because, at the end of the day, this stuff's entertainment, right? Mm. And if you can't handle it, stay home. If you can't handle this kind of stuff, if you can't handle the chance of an Austin Gomez coming and making you upset, and you're gonna stoop that low and be that low of a scumbag of a human being, stay home.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're an Iowa fan, don't bring those kinds of people.
Yeah.
And personally, I don't think this has anything to do with the Iowa Hawkeyes. I think the Iowa Hawkeyes get the short end or the short straw a lot of times because of, you know, the persona that they have. But there's shitty people in every fan base. I don't care who you are. I don't care if it's the freaking Packers. I don't care if it's the Cubs. I don't care if it's, you know, whoever. There's just shitty people. And when you have that many people in one place, you know, someone's going to cross the line. Get them out of there. That fan should be banned forever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the athletes want to experience something like Carver, but something like that could easily spoil an experience for them and then for, like, anybody who has to encounter that as well.
Yeah. I mean, the boo birds are fine. Somebody flipped them off.
We all know where the line is.
Somebody flipped them off. You know, you can – I personally would never flip off a, you know, an 18-year-old kid or whatever, but who knows how old that, or not, Gomez, he's, what, 21, 22?
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, these are 18 to 22-year-old kids. If you can't handle it, stay home.
Mm-hmm.
Just stay home. I don't like talking about this stuff. You guys know this, but at the end of the day, I think something needs to be said about fans that cross the line. And I think we kind of forgot how to act because there wasn't fans for so long.
Mm-hmm.
And some fans are just, you know, worse than others. Clearly, something was said here. You know, this guy should be banned for life. I think that's really all that we need to say about that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All right, next topic here. Before we get to this topic, though, guys, hit subscribe. Hit subscribe. 3,000 subscribers or 3,100 subscribers. Let's get to 3,200, why don't we? Hit subscribe. Join our Discord down below. Click that. We have, it's literally an active daily chat about college wrestling at all times in real time. So go check it out. Scroll down. Click that. All right, we have an AJ Ferrari update. As you guys know, he got in a pretty bad accident, 2 weeks ago?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's a lot of left in the dark about what actually happened with AJ. And your boy is almost back. He hasn't really made any posts. He posted
been quiet on socials.
He did. He has been posting on his Instagram story, which is different than making an actual, like, feed post about what happened. He's being quiet. But we did see this picture surface on the wrestling room forum.
So that's the best update we've really got so far, but he's looking good.
Looking good. They said that he's walking around. John Smith did a little press conference where he said that he's getting treatment. He's been to Gallagher, and you know, I don't know if we see him before Big 12s, but I'm getting the feeling that he's going to be back, don't you?
That's what I've been thinking from the start. We haven't really known the extent of the injuries, but just from what I saw, I figured if we see him again, it'll be postseason, and this is promising.
Yeah, this is promising. But I think, you know, considering how bad his car looked and everything like that, this is a great update to see him walking around. And obviously, when it comes to life and death situation, wrestling is not even in the, you know, who cares at that point if you know, if he comes back this year or not. He's still going to be one of the greatest college wrestlers of all time when it's said and done. You win the title as a freshman at 197 pounds, entertained as many people as he has, you know.
Right.
Everybody wants to see him wrestle.
He'll be back.
It sucks that we're not going to get to see him this weekend at Bout at the ballpark. Him and Jacob Warner would be a great duel. And, you know, Oklahoma State, they've been losing too. They've lost three in a row. Then if they lose to Iowa this Saturday, it'll be four in a row. Yeah. So
it's been different since Ferrari had to depart for a bit.
If you're an Oklahoma State fan, you're definitely cheering for AJ Ferrari to be back.
Yeah.
All right. Another update. All right. Let's talk about Northern Colorado. We got Justin Gaethje sitting mat side. I know what you guys are thinking. You're probably thinking, who cares about some celebrity sitting mat side at a Northern Colorado versus Wyoming duel? Well, how many other programs out there have a freaking UFC champion, contender, interim champion, and now he's going to be fighting for the belt coming up against Charles Oliveira, I believe. I think that fight's already announced and signed and everything. But, you know, when we went there, we were able to go and see his name on the wall, and we got to talk to the people that were there and say, how involved is he? And I don't think he's a guy that's there all the time, and, you know, who knows if he's like some sort of donor nowadays. But to see him mat side sitting there at a program like Northern Colorado, that's got to be – that's got to feel good for the wrestlers that are there, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. See someone like that in Greeley. That's awesome.
And I think so many times in wrestling, we want to bring up the same celebrities in our sport over and over and over, right? And I think that this UFC, you know, it's getting huge. It's becoming one of the biggest sports. It's probably the fastest growing sport. I feel like people say that all the time about every sport. Mm. But I think the UFC and the MMA thing, like, everybody kind of knows these guys, right? And there's so many wrestlers that come from – there's so many fighters that come from wrestling that I feel like, you know, we need to do a better job as like the wrestling media podcast or whatever to kind of shine light and kind of bridge that gap between the two. You know, I look at the engagements that we have anytime we do post any sort of UFC related content, and our audiences are different on Instagram and Twitter. If I post something about a UFC, if it's like a UFC post having to do with wrestling on Twitter, it doesn't get nearly the engagement as like it does on Instagram. And I think because we have a younger audience over on Instagram, and you know, the UNC Bears wrestling account, like, posting this, like, smart move, you know,
for sure,
smart move. You should want to show people, you know, hey, we're going to Northern Colorado. There's a chance that, you know, if you have goals of fighting after this is all done, You know, you got a guy like Justin Gaethje in your corner to help you out. You also have, I'm pretty sure Andrew Lears has been open, or he's talked about he's wanting to fight when he's done. I know he's got a brother that fights, and I can't remember his first name, but I think he's pretty legit. So
nice.
You know, if you're a program like Northern Colorado and you got guys like Trevor Whitman lives out there, the dude who stole Dillashaw, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, that whole deal. He's out there. Do you remember his name? Mikey trained there for a little bit.
It's not, you're not thinking of GSP, are you? Are you thinking of Dillashaw too?
No, Dillashaw went and trained with this dude. I'm blanking on his name on top of my head.
I know what you
the
mean
whole
too.
Deal with Uriah Faber. Anyways, if you're a program like Northern Colorado, you might, you know, I love that they're hitting that angle, showing like, hey, Justin Gaethje's here. Yeah. Come to one of our dual meets. Support us. Come wrestle for us. It's a great look for them. All right, let's move on. All right, this is obviously a topic. This is more of a stalemates topic. So if you're new to us and you don't know who we are, we do this thing called Stalemate Street League. And we have all kinds of wrestlers on this. We've literally had a female match where neither one of them have wrestled a match before. We've had Kyven Gatson, who's an NCAA champion and, you know, world team member. Yeah, world team member alternate, Olympic alternate, you name it. Kyven Gatson's a man. We've had guys like Colton McChrystal, who's an absolute stud, and I think Colton McChrystal could go out there and he could compete in some of these senior level tournaments and get some good wins, place, maybe even win the thing. Who even knows? So we have guys and girls from all different levels of wrestling. But one of the main stars of this whole thing is my cousin. And he goes by the name Mikey England. And his nickname is The Maniac. And he got to fight this past Sunday in front of Dana White. And some of you guys might know the Nelk Boys. He fought in front of the Nelk Boys for a chance to get signed by Dana White and the Nelk Boys for this TV show that they have on YouTube. So it was a YouTube show. Is that what you just call it?
Yeah.
Called Looking for a Fight, where Dana White goes to a certain city and he... It's shot like a reality show. So what they do is they go to like some restaurant, they eat the local food, they'll do some sort of event, or they'll do some sort of like sometimes they go bull riding was one of them. They did another one where they cut a bull's nuts and ate it. Like they just do random stuff in that city. And this next episode that they're doing is in Kansas City. This is where Mikey fights. He fights and trains out of Glory MMA in this organization called FAC. The FAC is almost like a feeder organization into the UFC. It's ran by some really smart guys. James Krause is a coach down there. So it's kind of become like a little hotbed for UFC. And Megan Anderson's down there. Zach Cummings is down there. Jeff Molina. They signed a kid, David Onama. Like multiple people coming from this gym to the UFC. Anyways, huge opportunity for Mikey. Half the arena was there for Mikey, it felt like. I didn't actually get to go in person, but here's this clip of the actual main UFC account talking about talking about Mikey and playing this clip. Look at that cut on it from his own.
The chant now of UFC from the Look at that. Mikey England fans here at Cable Dahmer Arena.
Listen, guys. So Mikey ended up not getting signed. They signed this kid. So Mikey won in the second or third round just by Khabib style ground and pound. And can you show it real quick? I'll let you guys watch it. There, that was it.
Yeah.
All right.
I think the blood, the sweat.
Just 1 second, guys.
He's
here we go.
Too slippery for Bucha to get a good
big
hold on
fist.
Yeah. So this Bucha guy, he's apparently a legend in this area. He fought in Bellator. He's fought in Strikeforce. He's just a veteran, brown belt jiu-jitsu guy, crafty, good on his feet, you name it. If you're a hardcore MMA fan, you'll probably know who he is. So this is a huge win for Mikey. And, you know, I appreciate anybody who's ever watched Stalemate Street League or anybody who's followed Mikey since then. It really does mean a lot to us. And, even though Mikey didn't get picked, they picked this dude that his name's Dulgarian. You guys need to watch out for him if you're a UFC fan. He got signed. I think he got signed by Nelk, and then he got signed by the UFC. So that dude's a savage. He went out there and just obliterated the guy really fast. Got the main event. So they went with him. It wasn't really something where we were like, you know, Mikey needs to get signed tonight or anything like that. But afterwards, you know, they showed a clip of Dana White. And Dana White was smiling ear to ear. So
during the UFC chant,
as soon as Mikey, if he ever gets the call one day, if you guys, you know, send him a tweet, tell him, you know, you appreciated watching him on Stalemate Street League. And you know, that's what this whole thing's about, man. Like, being able to see everybody's replies last night, who some people know Mikey before Street League because he wrestled for Mizzou. He's really good. He was a round of 12 guy, wrestled at Iowa State. If you're from the state of Iowa, you probably know him. But the fact that there's so many people that know him through Street League is awesome.
Really cool to see.
And a lot of people know him in the Kansas City scene as well because he's been fighting in the Kansas City FAC for a while now. And I think he's like, what, 10-1 or something?
Yeah, professionally 7-1 now.
Yeah, something crazy. Yeah. So
Street League made, baby.
Yep. So shout out to Mikey, man. And all credit to him, man. He's been freaking busting his butt since we were kids. And he's really set the precedence in our family for, like, you know, sports and in general. Like, it was me and his brothers. I'm sure you probably, you know.
Totally.
So shout out to Mikey. We want to thank him because a lot of these guys that wrestle on Street League and girls, like, they're not doing it for the money. Like, nobody's doing this for the money. They do it for the love of the sport. They do it for, you know, the love of Stalemates or whatever it is. And it's awesome.
Yeah.
All right. Good show. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you guys next week. And hit subscribe. Check out our sponsors, all that. Peace.